You're in the show.
This episode is proudly brought to you by Optimum Financial Services Group. Optimum has the expertise to guide you through investment, tax, retirement, and estate planning, with a tailored solution to your individual needs. Our objective is to provide you with an optimum solution to protect your wealth. Optimum has expertise in medical aid, legal services, asset finance, and short-term insurance, as well as specialized services in commercial, marine, aviation, and personal liability. Don't choose the average. Choose Optimum. Optimum Financial Services Group is an authorized financial services provider. Well, very good afternoon to you, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for joining me today. I am super excited, privileged, and really looking forward to this conversation with Springbok Nude Girls, Arno Carstens and Theo Crous. Sorry for the delay. We're going to get right into it now. My name is Alex MacPhail. This is High Performance Teams. Arno, Theo, how's it going today? Thank you so much for your time today. I appreciate you come straight out of the studio. How are you guys doing?
Cool.
I think we're all sitting in our studio.
Yeah, you do look good.
Carstens look high dev, and I look like standard dev.
Maybe just put in your camera, Theo.
Oh, man. Okay. Well, maybe you can just move a little closer to the camera. Or move the camera closer to you. Cool.
Literally, it's getting better.
There we go. You look 10 years younger already.
Oh, my goodness.
Oh, it's awesome. Well, I want to just start off with saying, you know, Arno, Theo, in turn, I'll ask Arno first. If you could sit down and talk to anybody this afternoon, anybody in the world, who would you talk to?
Theo, go first.
I'll talk to David Crosby and ask him why he said meh to the Van Halen. Did you hear about that?
I don't know the story. Tell me the story.
I asked him on Twitter, what do you think of the death of Eddie Van Halen?
Yeah.
What do you think of Eddie Van Halen's guitar playing? And then David Crosby replied saying, meh. He said, meh.
People were upset
with him, and then he said, then he reiterated the thing, and he said, "Listen, he didn't really mean that, but what he means is doesn't really like his guitaring or something like that." And then people freaked out again, and then like a day later, he said, "Oh, sorry, he didn't know he died."
Okay, all right.
Sorry, yeah. She's like, "I'm sorry, I didn't know he passed away."
Okay, Arno, have you got an answer yet? I've given you an extra minute there to think. Don't overthink.
Okay. I think Jack Nicholson.
That's quite a cool one. Very cool.
I just want to sit and listen to the stories.
Yeah, it'll be awesome.
Old Ronnie.
Actually, would like to talk to Donald Trump just to ask him what are you doing? Just ask him, what have you been thinking all this time? What are you doing with, what are you doing? That's what I want.
There's a lot of guys you want to ask that question to, man.
Okay, cool.
Yeah.
Well, the reason I bring it up is because, you know, I have a list of people that I'd like to talk to. And in the top five of those people is you guys, you know, as a youth. So I just want you to get a sense of how excited I am about this conversation today. As a youth growing up in Cape Town, you know, formative years, Springbok Nude Girls, man, it was like they were the band. You guys are the band. And if you'd rewind the times 20 years ago and you said, hey, one day you're going to just sit down and have a little chat to these guys, I would have maybe said no ways. So anyways, I'm letting you know, I like you guys. Oh, cool. I love the music, and it's awesome that that you guys have agreed to join me. So thank you very much. Appreciate it.
Awesome. Thank you very much, Alex. Great
so,
chat with you.
Yeah. So we I haven't done this three-way conversation much. I've done it once before, and it does get a little challenging. So if you see that you maybe just a little bit shifted, if you could just shuffle yourself a little bit so we get a nice positioning. Yeah, that's cool. Awesome. Okay, and the other quite cool thing is, Arno, you in there, I mean, is it going to be one of those conversations? You're in my old belly, you know, I grew up in the southern suburbs in Cape Town, and you're living in that part of the world, so that's also quite a cool connection for me too. But, yeah, I mean, high-performance teams is what I'm on about, and I hope you appreciated the little tribute, the bubblegum soundtrack to a new music video suggestion. Silver Falcons aerobatic team, that nice footage on board. That was a team that was flying about 12 years ago. They made a video, and I just quickly ripped it and changed the sound to put your song on, which is quite cool. So maybe if you want to relook at a video one day, we should put some flying in it. I think that'll be quite cool.
Well, we don't have a video for that song. So
okay, so the opportunity is there. We can tee it up. Yeah, and the home of the Silver Falcons is not very far from you guys. Within an hour and a half, you'll be there. So we should maybe see that.
You know what? Actually, for that song, we did have a video. Like, we had this. I don't know if you can remember. I don't know, but it's we were just starting. We had no money, and then this post company came to us and asked us if they can make a video. And they did the first like minute and a half of Bubblegum My Boots, and then they said, oh, this is how it looks, and so if you want to finish it, it's going to cost money. And then something like that. I don't know how but anyway, so we didn't have money, so remember that. And then we like, oh, we can't finish it, and so we had a minute and a half video of that song.
And then we also went in and did with a modeling company. We did a video for, I think, Bruce Bleed and Supergirl, where they wrapped cellophane around my face and I was in a wheelchair.
All right.
And all that stuff. And then the boss of the modeling company got arrested for fiddling with the, you know, with the youngsters.
Okay.
And but we saw a little bit of the videos. Everything was then on Betamax still or something.
Okay. Giving away the age there, Betamax. Wow. Cool. I really enjoyed that documentary that came out in the last couple of years. I watched it the last few weeks ago. And I must just say thank you to Mark Taylor again for setting this up for us. You know, he also featured in the video. We had a chat a few weeks ago. And it was really like a nice summary and a bit of a timeline story of your journey. And what was quite poignant for me was to see the raw footage that you guys had of that first tour to London, you know, a bunch of sort of young guys having not traveled much, and this is it, to the wide new world. I mean, you must have enjoyed also the journey with having had this documentary created now. What are your thoughts or looking at the documentary and thinking back to the time that was the Nude Girls sort of stardom and you know, major success? Did you look back at it and think, wow, was that us? Or, you know, your journey has gone on quite far since then.
Yeah, I think we...
Yeah, go Theo.
It's evident from that footage that you know, now people are more trained in the ways of being in front of a camera and conducting an interview, and and when we went over, we were so well, I was at least like either shy or I don't know how to express myself in footage. So all the footage are like useless footage because we're always like making a joke or laughing or trying to be funny. We didn't really see the value of explaining stuff thoroughly. So all of that, but all the footage is like, you know, we filmed the stuff that like, if you go through that footage, I can't actually believe we got a documentary out of that footage, because mainly is like us, this is us at the train station.
Yeah.
This is us in the tube. This is us on Trafalgar Square. Us at Piccadilly Circus. You know, it's not, we're not really like like engaging like normal people will engage with a camera and actually form like stuff that is actually useful, like ask someone to form the actual show, or or before the show. It's all just like we literally were forming the thing like tourists. Like I'm going there with my I'm going there with my brother, and we're going to sit on Trafalgar Square and we're going to talk nonsense there.
Okay, well, look, maybe we can take this opportunity to set the record straight then, because look, I enjoyed it and it was raw and rough, but it was actually a nice insight into the teamwork. So a couple of themes that I want to explore with you guys today, please, is, you know, I see this as a high-performing team. You know, this is the sort of theme of the show, and to go with it, high-performance teams have to do a couple of key things. Firstly, they have to operate well, but how do they do that? And it's a principle of incremental gain. So, you know, every day you just try and be a little bit better, and certainly musicians and bands that want to perform, you'll have some kind of a set of preparation, deliver the show well, and then also review it. How did it go? What can we do better? So that's one of the themes I want to talk about, is this constant review and improvement process. And another theme that I want to get to is the creativity and the, you know, there's a lot of discussion recently about what does creativity look like, where does it come from, and you know, if it, do you just wait for this lightning bolt thing to happen, or do you realize you need to put in the discipline and say, well, for X amount of hours a day or a week, I have to sit down and be creative, sit at my desk and write. So if anything resonates there with you, Arno, maybe you want to just share some thoughts on the performance of the team growing or creativity.
So basically from very early on, we've learned from, with the Springbok Nude Girls, that the whole teamwork thing was obviously key to any kind of success there.
Yeah.
Not only between the band, but also with Mark Taylor, Gerard, and Delmain. We were a big, nice team. I mean, Mark Taylor's a fantastic guy. You know, it was nice to have those guys on board with us. It made us kind of feel safe in a way. But then that obviously goes further and right through your career. I mean, that is very instrumental to anything successful. When it comes to creativity, I think we get better at spending our energies at the right place the older we get. I feel more creative now than what I did back then. I mean, I'm surely definitely writing more music now. But the thing is, what is lovely about youth is there's a certain sense of ignorance, and you come up with brilliant stuff just because you don't. There's no filters, so that is the secret, I think, of those first two albums of most artists. That is just normally a breakthrough kind of stuff, and I really do think that with the Springbok Nude, we did have that kind of feeling, and you know, there was a feeling of success when it came to the music, and then also straight through to the live from the live straight through the whole organization of the company.
Okay, that's cool. I like that. I like your concept there of no filters. You know, this idea, but obviously there's a sense of filtering. I mean, you want to develop and produce a certain quality, a certain sound, a certain look, a certain image, a certain energy, and you will be filtering it. But in general, you're controlling the filter, and you have this this sense of I'll do what I want. And that came out very clearly in the documentary where they were trying to guide you with Sony or I can't remember the exact person at the time, trying to guide you to say less of these songs, more of these songs. But you say no. This is our music, and we're choosing.
Well, we're a democracy in the band, and we vote on things, and you know, We like what we do. It's every song is your child, and you kind of love it, even if it's even if the child is not so fantastic. You only find that out 6 months later, but you're going to fight for all your songs. So that is my experience.
Okay, Theo, any thoughts on the filtering or the ownership? I love that concept, and Mark brought it up before that you guys did things a little differently as a band. You kind of all had say and all had input and all had ownership, and it seemed like it was an equal partnership, even though there was a lead person and a lead songwriter, etc. But you were all equals in the band. Any thoughts on that?
So I think from a business perspective, we certainly didn't know about any other bands that were having business meetings every week. We had a business meeting every week on a Sunday, and we would sit and strategize and think what we're going to do next and discuss these things in depth and made cognizant decisions on where we wanted to go as a band. Stuff that we didn't really think about like earlier when we started. But with Mark, what Mark brought in was a sense of structure and a compartmentalization of business and creativity, so that we have that time to discuss what we need to discuss regarding where we want to go in a business sense, and then have the band practices, you know, to explore songwriting. I'm busy studying creativity right now, so it's something that interests me. I think the way the Nude Girls works best is a democracy works up to a point in a band, but I think the more important thing than having the democracy is having all five individuals, or how many individuals in that creative group, understanding what their principle is in the creative group. So not everybody's a great songwriter, not everybody's a great lyricist.
Or drummer. Or keyboard spieler.
And so some people are better at certain things. And when you find, like, sometimes you get a musician that's technically so brilliant, but doesn't have any idea about songwriting. And those things get blurred, because having to be a songwriter, like Arno, is a different thing from being a technically great musician. It's a different part of your brain. You're teaching mechanics to your arms, and your hand is, you know, that thing is something else than the other thing that happens when you're structuring something or making a song, and you think about an idea and how to tell the story. So I think the important thing within the structure of the Nude Girls, even though it was a democracy, is that each band member worked on their strengths rather than trying to be what they weren't. So
okay.
Arno, for instance, is very great. He's great at adding things to an existing structure. So he's part, although he does have structure suggestions and chord suggestions, his ideas are centered around filling in and painting over what is already there.
Or talking suggesting
That is his strength. If you look at like Francois' drumming, there's that song Blue Eyes of Us, and then every time Arno sings roundabout now, Francois actually mimics his hi-hat with what Arno's singing. So he goes, he actually does what Arno does. So rhythmically actually followed the vocal line.
Oh wow.
Yeah, so it's small things like that you only realize much later. People probably did unknowingly or knowingly, but there are certain things that is in a band, and although it's a democracy, you realize what your strength is, and you work on on that. And even though, yes, you do have a say in the songwriting, and yes, you do have a say in the structure of the song and what the beat must do, but if you know that your strength is not deciding what that thing is going to be, then rather not leave that suggestion to the two members in the band that knows about these things, you know.
Yeah. So, okay. Theo, thanks. You've answered that well, but you've brought so many things that I want to now pick up on there. I could keep going all day on this one. Firstly, is that, you know, this, you're doing your PhD in creativity and music is wonderful, and I want to get to that. But before we jump off this, you also mentioned Ardrown and the trumpet. It's such a beautiful, unique sound. You know, it really, it came out, you know, at the time when the sounds were coming out, the South African public was hungry for something rocky, something heavy, but also that trumpet coming through, it just breaks it a little bit, adds the spice, as he says in the documentary. It's very nice, and it really does make the sound just so unique to the Springbok Nude Girls. Was that something, it seemed to be that something that just was an instant hit? You came around and you guys sort of had a jam session and you knew right away. Was it that easy?
I think it was that easy, yes. But it also played against us later in our career when we went to New York, and, you know, we had the guy, I think his name was Gerard Babbitt. He came, he signed Cypress Hill, and he was in charge of all the bands outside the US signing on, and he listened to our stuff and he really liked it. But the main feedback was, what the fuck was the trumpet doing there? And like, people didn't understand. Like, for us, it's kind of inherent to township music and the way we listen to African jazz influenced stuff. There's always a trumpet in there, and so we didn't really think about it like that at all, you know, because
it is obvious. Yeah,
it's just obvious. It must be there. But if you listen to the bands at the time, so the bands at the time was Creed, Pearl Jam, Soundgarden, Alice in Chains. Creed came later. But like, but that was the bands that were selling. They were selling at the time.
Yeah.
So when we saw Sony, we were so far removed from that whole modern rock or the grunge. It was first the grunge and then the modern rock that Creed came afterwards, but like, we were so far removed from those bands that it had to take someone to really, really invest a lot in us and go like, okay, cool, this will be this I can see will be the next best.
Great idea.
Yeah,
you know, but if you look at from a record company perspective, someone that looks at the band and go like, do they really fit in with what's going on in America right now? You'll probably go, no, this is not something.
Hang on. Remember, there's also the other thing that we found out about it is that, look, I think personally, the fact that we had a trumpet in it and that we sound a little bit different than other people is our strongest point.
It is definitely
what makes us stand out. So, for conformity, I hear what Theo's saying. But then there was also this other thing, of course, with the record company deals, which was so interesting, that if you would be signed in South Africa, Sony South Africa or whatever record company, then you'll be like 80%, you know, they own you. There's no reason for America, Sony America or Sony UK to invest in you, because they won't ever make any money out of you. So that is actually the problem with rock bands or whatever, with record companies, that kind of stifle your growth. So you always will be stuck in your little territory in a certain way.
Okay.
And that is something that's
interesting. So I want to ask you, but
in a big way,
is that because just put some easy numbers on it. So you sign a deal for 3 years or 5 years or 10 albums or whatever, and then Sony, whichever company abroad, would not take you because you're under that deal? Or is it a sort of a territory issue? Is it just because you're affiliated with somebody?
So it will be a sub-label. So it will be a sub-deal, you know. So you'll have your main percentage and your main deal will go through Sony South Africa. but they were licensed then to Sony America, and that deal that they make with them will be a smaller deal than the deal that they've already made with us. So the money that that Sony United States will make out of us is considerably less than what someone in South Africa will make of us, because we already did the deal here. So they're doing a sub deal. It's not like they go like, okay, cool, Sony America, take your 15% take your 85%. They go, okay, well, we're just going to license this stuff because we own it. So you get, like, I don't know what the percentages are, but it won't be, it's not like you're signed to Sony worldwide. You just signed to Sony South Africa.
Well, folks are joining, and I just want to put some comments up. This gentleman, you guys don't know, Mark, saying, what are each of you listening to at the moment? Please bring your questions and comments. I'm just going to flash through a couple of people are saying, what? The trumpet is brilliant. So support from your fans. The trumpet is agreed. Arno, what are you listening to at the moment? We're going to get to your concert, your new album that's coming up tomorrow. But what are you listening to at the moment? What's your influence?
Okay, now, so on Apple Music, I make my own playlists. So I've done 72 of them already. So if you just go there, you can take off, you check everything. But I mean, this. So I invest to listen to new stuff, to hear what's out there in production and stuff. There's a lot of cool stuff. I mean, okay, so Deftones has got a new album out and a couple of really cool songs.
The new album is lekker.
What is that band of yours, Theo, that you were saying that you enjoyed?
All Them Witches.
Yeah, they've got also very interesting stuff. But there is a lot of cool stuff. If you actually go to the playlist, it is endless hours of beautiful music.
You sent me like six of them, and then never again I got a playlist ever again. I got like 1 to 7. Every now and again I'll get like 42, but I don't have all of them.
All right, I'll go have a look there. That's cool.
Just to go back to the trumpet thing, I agree with Arno wholeheartedly. Like that is what makes our band. That is special, and we embrace it. I was just trying to explain that the people of the rest of the world didn't embrace it. They were like, what is it doing here? But that is the thing that makes us, you know? But I don't think a lot of people at the time saw it, you know?
No, I think it's amazing. I want to just bounce back to you, Arno, about this creativity and songwriting. Another thing that stood out in the documentary was Arden was busy explaining the kind of unique characteristics, as you were saying now, Theo, that the energy and the way people bring stuff towards the band and their unique strength. And you mentioned that you can just pull out a bag of lyrics or a bag of, you know, a verse or a chorus or something. You've got this sort of wealth. Are you writing in your head all the time? Are you writing it down on paper on your computer all the time? What is your songwriting process look like?
So I write songs, and then I get bored, and then I paint a bit, and I get bored, and then I write again. And so that's what an all day kind of looks like now that I'm not touring anymore much. And otherwise I'm in the studio with Theo on Tuesdays. We're busy mixing the new album, or I'm with Charlie or somebody else mixing another song. But the thing is, you just constantly writing. But remember, when we were young, it was more in the 90s, it was just a stream of consciousness, you know. Nirvana had the biggest song, Teen Spirit, back then, and I still don't know what he's singing. You know what I mean? It wasn't really about the lyrics. As long as the lyrics are colorful and interesting, and that was what we were going for back then. And I'm still the same person, but I think these days, the older with age now, I definitely think about it more and I write more than just rocking up and spitting out from the top of my head, you know.
So I think the first album, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think the first album we wrote down the lyrics after we recorded the album, because we needed to submit it to Samro, you know, songwriting, and so we wrote down the lyrics. I know, write down after we did it.
Yeah,
I don't figure out. What am I saying? What is he thinking there? Wow, that's brilliant. Some brilliant project for me.
Cool. A comment coming through on YouTube from Mark saying, I remember watching the Nude Girls on Just Ginger late 90s in Cape Town. Best carefree times of my life. Well, I got to concur with you, Mark. And I want to pick up on an event. I came to watch you guys at the Troubadour in Cork Bay, across from the Brass Bell.
Yeah.
This is the first time that I was going to watch you guys live. It was, I think I was, I don't know, 17 or 18 at the time. And we were all fired up. I think it was a Friday night there. And somebody just got a bit ahead of themselves, and they let off the fire extinguisher. And that Troubadour was a small, compact little room, and it was just smoke everywhere, and everyone had to be evacuated, and we were outside for about an hour. And I just had this fear, like, they've destroyed it, and you guys are going to be pissed off, and you're not going to play the show now if the guys can't control themselves. And I was just saying, please, just don't cancel. And about an hour later, we went back in, and then you guys played, and it was awesome.
Yay!
It was
just
so glad.
Just a great night.
One at Bird, but what's that place there? By Cork Bay, the bar, the front there. We did one show there. I've got off a whole collage of photos of that one show.
Right.
I'll never forget the story where there's a story that Robin Auld, because that is his area, okay. Robin Auld, the singer, that he's a big surfer dude. So he came in on the wave. It was high tide, and he surfed in, and his audience were waiting for him in the Brass Bell, and he surfed in, got in through the window, got on stage, and did his show. I love that story. I think it's true.
Yeah, there was a great wave there at Cork Bay, the Cork Bay Reef, and I can imagine that must have been a beautiful day.
I cannot surf the wave.
No. I went out there once, and I got taken out badly, and I didn't go out again. That's quite a tricky wave.
No, I look at it and I go, no, I'm not going to make it. I watch the corporate riff, I'm like, I'm not going to make it there anytime soon.
I want to also then just touch on something then, Arno. So I'm going through a transition myself here where I've just left my career as an airline pilot. I've been flying for 21 years now in the Air Force.
Are you
before.
Crazy?
Yeah, it's a position in life where I'm moving on. And this brings me to my question for you. There must have been some sense of trepidation for you stepping away and becoming a soloist. I know you guys all did different things, and there was various reasons for it. But give me a sense of your fears, your thoughts, your expectations at the time where you're now going to say, well, I'm going to carry on, but it's going to be Arno Carstens and no longer the Springbok Nude Girls.
Well, I tell you, I remember the last gig that we did. You know, the last one was supposed to, and then. I still thought life will just be going on kind of in a weird way, but it didn't. It literally is that thing where the phone calls stop ringing, you know, where the phone calls stop ringing.
Yeah.
And just dead in the water. So I thought my music career was over, and I just wrote an album for myself, in, you know, kind of thing. And then some friends of mine invested in doing the demo, and then we recorded the album, and it came out. And then Volkswagen picked it up for the ad, and then it all happened again. But, you know, kind of you get broken down. So reality of these situations is, and it's actually a beautiful thing because it liberates you. You know, you must let defeat sometimes take you. Because it liberates you in a way. And then I think the stuff that comes out of you then is kind of more pure. That's why I think Another Universe was such a successful album. Interesting. It's a very interesting thing. You're scared, but it's a good thing.
Just before the solo album, I ran into Arno at the, like, there's an engine shop there at, there's a garage there at, in Orange Street. Mm-hmm. And, Arno, you were still driving that Datsun of yours. Pure class. That's like a light blue Datsun. And like we had it, I don't know why, because I just stayed up the road. So we just chatted, and things were so bad. Like, Arno wasn't making money. Like, it was so bad. Like, he stayed with his brother, and like, I wasn't, like, no one was really doing anything, you know. And then he said he wrote this album, and never. It was just before Alistair and Mike invested in Arno, so things were just really very bad. And like literally a year later, the ad came out, and yes,
nice.
Is that something that you drove, Arno? This VW ad, or did it come from your side?
It was totally a fluke. Like this guy who does ads, friend of Alistair King's, he threw it over as almost just a placement track. And when they showed it to the, customers, to the client, it worked very well. Of course, they wanted probably a different track, but it worked so well that they went with it. That's a story I know.
Who did the ad? Was it Greg Gray? Who directed that ad? Was it Greg Gray or?
Remember, we had tea with him the other night, me, you, and Alistair, and Art.
That guy.
Yeah.
This is some code word going on.
No, names.
I forgot. No. Ricky Boyd edited it. Ricky put the thing on the vibe. On the thing, and I think Gordon Ray, who's now with Saatchi and Abel, I think he was at Ogilvy at the time, and I think he was the CD on that job. Him and Chris Gotts, I think. If I'm correct. Yeah. Okay. So. Weird.
At a similar time then, for you, Theo, now again, you're in this engine of the Springbok Nude Girls, there's momentum and there's a vibe and a sort of top of your game at that point. You guys split up and do your own thing. And you get into producing. I know you were involved in a bit of producing along the way too, but obviously it's now a bit more, you know, you have to get stuck in here. But you end up becoming quite a successful producer for some of the other top bands in South Africa. You know, how was your journey in that? Was this something that you did out of necessity? Or did you lean in hard to this because it was fun? Or, I mean, were you nervous about this? What are your thoughts at the time becoming a producer? You were part of a band before.
It was automatic because in the Nude Girls, my job was mostly to structure stuff. And so inadvertently, unknowingly to me, I became a producer by default, and it was probably I don't think anybody in the band really wanted to have that job, so I kind of just did it, and it was really produced by all of us. But I was the only guy in the band that knew a couple of technical things more than the other members in the band, so I didn't know a lot more, but I knew something more, you know, about EQ and whatever.
I didn't even know what a producer is.
I just did it because I didn't know what else to do. And so when we did that first album, the guy where we recorded said, well, you must mix it. And then I kind of just moved levels. Like, you'll even hear in that song, Bruce Bleed, there's a middle part of that song. Because we're on the last song and we don't have any more time left, and there's a snare drum that goes ka 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 ka, and the guy said in the middle of the bounce said the snare drum's too loud, and I went, oh goodness, and I put the snare drum down in the mix, and all of a sudden there's no snare drum in the rest of the mix. There's just no snare drum, and that is how that song is. That's that song. I didn't know we were in the middle of bouncing the mix. So I just turned down the snare drum halfway through the song, and that's just how it came out. And so inadvertently, another friends of ours, Lithium, they had massive success at the time, and they said, well, don't you want to produce our album? But I was like, I don't even know what I did. You know, it just said it said on the Neanderthal cover that I produced it, but I didn't know what was going on. I don't even know why.
Theo, your story reminds me of how Johnny Depp and those actors. I love these audio books, and I've done the audio book of some of these Brat Pack guys in the 80s and how they became successful. Was just because there was nobody really else. Fantastic, isn't it?
Yeah. But there was no other guy, so they're like, let's ask that guy because his album's doing well and the drums are kind of dry. And our previous album, there was lots of verb on the drums, and this Nude Girls album, there's no verb, partly because we didn't have any reverb unit. Arno sang on an effects guitar effects pedal just to add effects to it, because there was no, like, you know, how you mix an album is you have all this outboard effects and then you put stuff on vocal. So Arno just sang in a shower, I think, where, with this guitar to create the reverb, you know. And so they just like produce our thing, and then that thing won an award, not for me but for the engineer Peter Paulson. He won an award for that. And and then someone else asked me, and I could never do full albums. I could only do EPs and stuff because in the band of the band. And then after the band ended, I think the first full length album I did was a friend of ours, Paul Flynn. He did an album called The Fields, which is still one of my favorite albums. It was the very first thing I did. I did that album. And then I did a Chris Chameleon album. And the Chris Chameleon album really did very well.
Very well. I saw Theo had a couple of Porsches. I must just say that. He was like, yeah, when the rock thing was still very, very big, Theo was like king.
Yes.
You're the producer here.
I had no sense of money. I think I could have probably paid my house off like at least 8 times for the amount of money I've spent on nonsense.
Yeah. Well, I think that comes with the territory of just being young and enjoying what you're doing, and you know, things come with it. And that echoes, I think, the sentiment. John joining us on LinkedIn saying this is fun. I agree, John, it is fun. And I want to bring in what is the fun times of being a band. Maybe if you could just share, Arno, when did it feel real? I mean, I imagine for me as a non-band member, when I'm going out to open for U2 and those sort of things, those are amazing opportunities. But there was obviously a time earlier than that. When did it feel real? Like, guys, we're doing this. You look around the stage and you see your mates on the stage with you. You look around the audience and you see thousands of happy people. When did it feel like, this is it, we did it?
I think it's that the first time you as a band write a cool song together, and then also the first time then you play a show and there's really good feedback and there's a vibe, that is a highlight. And then the first time you hear your song on radio, and then the first time for us it was a big highlight for us was opening for In Excess, hanging out. I mean, Michael Hutchinson at that stage, He was like the closest thing to Jim Morrison in a way. The way he moved on stage, the way he could sing, it was just fantastic to be a fly on the wall, sharing the stage with him and hanging out backstage and checking out all their stuff. You know, it was a lot of that kind of stuff. And then, of course, winning a song, it's always the first thing still, I mean, I get it now when we're busy writing a good song, then that's still gives you that high. That's part of the whole thing of creating stuff and being artists. So it's fantastic. Mm-hmm. It is the bonus points of the job.
Sure. I think of us, one day we played in Pretoria, and I think Blue Eyes was just released, and we played Pretoria that night on an open field, and it was just us and, like, I don't know, one or two other bands, and there was 18,000 people at that show. And I mean, we were used to playing bigger stages with other acts, but there was 18,000 people just to see us. And that was that was amazing for me to see that we can draw so many people in a country very much rock alternative listening audience. No, there's only a couple of million people, of which I don't know, a couple of 100,000 maybe might listen to our stuff. So that was amazing to have that many people at our show. For me, was like, yes, I could not believe that so many people want to see us, you know.
When you get in there, yeah. But I want to also just share a parallel story then with you guys too. I mean,
10 years ago when I was in the Air Force. I flew in the display team and we would do air shows. And in the early days, you'd get to a point where, you know, it's just all wonderful. Like, people are giving you cars to use on the weekend, and you know, you walk around and people just see the uniform. They don't see the individual, unfortunately. They see the uniform. You know, that's, he must be one of them. But the we'll call it thrill, but you know, the enjoyment out of doing a nice show. It's about 15 minutes long, and it's precision and it's hard work, etc. However, at the end of the show, you kind of get together as the group and you debrief for 10, 15 minutes and you discuss. Yeah. And the first few minutes of that debrief is always just, well, if it was the case, which mostly it was, wow, guys, that was awesome. And as you get into it further on, like, you know, the next year and the next year, the debrief is still awesome because it's an amazing thing, but you start to get more critical, you know, like, yeah. When you made that call, I felt like it was a third of a second slower than normal at my reaction. You know, those kind of things start to creep in later on. When did it become more serious for you guys then, Arno? Like, when did you say, well, hey, this is amazing, and the first, but now, guys, that show was good, but you know what, we could do this. Did you guys get together after performance or straight to a beer, or, you know, how did it get more serious for you guys?
Look, the best part of the show is almost straight after the show, when you walk off and you're sweaty and you're stuck and you give each other hugs full of sweat. It's such a good and high. So I know exactly that feeling you're talking about. But I can imagine getting out of an aeroplane after some stunts and stuff. That must be exactly the same feeling. I never, you know, new tricks, technologies come out and new tricks comes out to try, for us to try and make our sound bigger and that it, that just sort of happened with time. But Theo, maybe you can elaborate.
Yeah, you see, I don't know. I think there was a certain part where we started planning which songs to play. I mean, we made some terrible calls, like straight, like serious calls. Like at one stage, I think for like a year or two, we thought ending with the biggest song we've ever had is not a good idea. So I don't know why we thought. So we thought like, let's not ever play Bubblegum My Boots ever again. So that's like the Stones going like, let's not play Satisfaction ever because people won't like it. And like, we just ended with some random song, you know, some song that we thought was awesome. And then, yeah. And then like after a while, we're like, why? Like, this is probably why people come here for that song, but we're not playing it. And like people ask, why don't you play that song? And we're like, we don't like the song anymore. You know, completely forget about the actual people that are paying your bills. Those are the people that you must look after. They bought the album. Just that was funny. And like for a whole year, we just didn't play that song. And like, the weirdest song we've ever done.
And you probably got lots of feedback about it too. What's interesting on that topic is that, you know, these new streaming apps, etc., like Spotify and things, you can see how many times people have played that song. And all these years later, the same songs are still getting played the most. And it's interesting to see this data coming through now with the modern technology.
So our song is, every week we get like a thing from Apple and Spotify, like what song.
Yeah.
And it's Blue Eyes and Bubblegum My Boots. And they're neck and neck. Like one has got like, I don't know how many thousand streams a week and then so many Shazams. And it's literally just those two songs that are Shazammed. And like, well, that makes the list, you know. Obviously other songs are. We had this thing called Baseball that's like it's a classical thing and it didn't make really sense, you know. And so Blue Eyes had like a great idea. It was an awesome idea. And so Blue Eyes and that had like millions of streams or whatever, you know, the countdown or whatever. But I had a notification the other day on Apple Music that the song Baseball has been streamed 5,000 times, like in its entirety. So in the 22 years that it's been since the dawn of analytics for Apple Music, someone has streamed that thing 5,000 times. And I was like, there you go.
The market's broken.
That's a milestone for that song.
Well, just a couple of comments coming through. Mark is joining and saying, I think when you have bras thrown at you, you're doing something right. And then this ties into what you were just saying now, Theo. Maybe the answer has already been put. Alistair King on LinkedIn saying, what's the worst Nude Girl song ever and who was to blame? So is that baseball?
No.
There's much worse songs than baseball.
No, baseball is a nice one.
Huh?
Sorry, lost you there. Say again, Arno.
The worst song is probably "I'm Your Friend," and that's both our faults. That's not even I can't even blame him for that. Because
I think we were going through our stage. We were listening to the band Ween a lot. Introduced the band Ween, and we thought that would be like. Kind of with that kind of alt humor. I am your friend. You know, that kind of vibe. There's a sense of sarcastic humor about it, but it doesn't translate. It just sounds like a happy song. So the people love it.
It's the intentions were really good for the song and the song was good, but the way we recorded it didn't translate into what we meant for me. Okay. So I was like,
I just thought, well, I don't know about this one.
Yeah.
So that's what that,
I very much was like.
Yeah. It's like that. Yeah. It's like that. That reply on the tweet. Same kind of response.
Yeah.
Well, I also enjoy the sort of the data behind things, and certainly in my own playlist, your Afterlife Satisfaction feature, the playlist numbers on my computer shows that those songs are way up in the top. Top five is those songs, and I know in the documentary you also had this little side bet going between Genie and Blue Eyes, and I also would have gone for Genie. But tell me about the replay or the new edition of Bubblegum. It's quite different, and obviously, you know, it's not high tempo and everything, but the acoustic version, as it were. What was the thought process on that?
I did on my album.
Yes.
Yeah, I just did a version of it slowed down. I heard Johnny Cash do a version of Bad Seeds from Nick Cave. Yeah.
Oh, he did the Mercy Seat.
The Mercy Seat, that's it. And for the first time, I could actually hear the lyrics. So I thought it would be a cool idea to do it in a ballad form, sort of where you can actually check out the lyrics a bit more.
Yes.
Yeah.
And are you happy with it? Like, where does it sit with you? And as creatives, you've got these things of what really worked and what wasn't so good. Sometimes you think this is brilliant, the market doesn't respond. Sometimes you think this is okay, the market loves it. How did that sort of ballad version sit for you, Arno?
It is what it is. It's not supposed to be a single, or I didn't expect anything of it. It's more personal thing that I just wanted to hear what it. I've always had it. I could hear it in my head. Okay. You know. What it would sound like. So I thought, why not put it down?
Okay, cool. Speaking of
that, we did another version of that song which we recorded at Metropolis, where the Libertines recorded and the Baby Shambles and all these guys in the UK. And we did another version of that song, which I think we only released in the United Kingdom. And
yeah, I don't.
It's so weird. Re-recording a song that everybody likes. Why do you want to re-record it?
Yeah, if you want to redo a song, do it completely different. But don't, you know, what we did in the UK where those guys trying to do that, they just say, the Bubblegum Boots is such a great song. We must just remix it so it sounds more, that it could sit better on radio today kind of thing. But it's impossible to do that magic again, kind of, to capture it. There's something so cool about the raw sound of the original.
It is. Yeah, I think I agree with that. I want to ask you one or two last questions before I let you go. Arno, your stage show is quite, you know, it's quite fluid, it's quite energetic. You visibly are enjoying yourself when you're on stage as well. Do you rehearse your sort of movements as well, or is that something that just comes at the time? I mean, I don't assume that you wouldn't put effort into creating the show, but do you actually rehearse sort of movements as well too, or does that sort of come out?
That's something that I also want to know.
What?
I also want to know if he stands in front of the mirror and goes, ah.
See, okay, here you go. Good. It's all you. Go for it.
No, I do not do that. It's all natural. But one thing we must do, and me and Theo, is probably get fit a little bit. So luckily the summit, so we've got a show coming up flipping soon. So it helps if you're a little bit fit.
I'm sure,
I still love the flip, man. It's cooking, you know. The songs are fast and it's a big energy. It's a tour de force.
Yeah.
You know, the Nude Girls show. So you got to be ready for it.
Okay, so let's Theo, so tell me what's happening now. So tomorrow you guys are releasing something great, and what was it? Rolling Thunder. So tell us about Rolling Thunder. What's happening? I saw a link on Facebook about that.
So we recorded that song a year and a half ago when all of the five original members were together. We had a songwriting session and we wrote about 13 songs. And through the last year, we've just been trying to, we recorded them, but they sounded very rough. And so Arno and myself and Francois have been getting together and polishing the songs and adding stuff to the structure. And, you know, like finishing them off like one a week.
Okay.
And so this song we finished first. And we asked a friend of ours, Lionel Smith. He's an incredible artist. We asked him if he doesn't want to shoot a video for us. And it was during COVID. So he just came into the studio and we shot the video in the studio in a day. And just thought we're going to.
2 hours, an hour and a half. Boop, boop.
Yeah.
Okay. Sounds good. All right. And is that what's being released tomorrow then, this video?
The video and the song. Yeah. I think the video's been released a bit later. I think that's the 26th of October. And tomorrow the single goes out on Spotify and Deezer, iTunes, and Tidal.
Awesome. Looking forward to it. Arno, you want a last question for you? You want to redo that bubblegum music video and you want to involve some flying? I think we should set a time and a date and we can maybe organize something for you guys to come and make a nice appearance.
Yes,
what are your thoughts on the music video?
I will.
Tell me.
We can make it happen.
Can we both fly in the thing together or do we have to be one at a time?
Well, it depends on what airplane we get, but what I'll do is I'll keep the conversation alive off air, and we'll take it from there, and we'll leave it as a teaser for the guests that tuned in today to see what music video we create.
Okay, cool.
Arno, Theo, thank you so much for your time today. It was awesome chatting with you. Really, really big fan of your guys' work. Awesome to hear that something new is coming out tomorrow, and we'll be in touch.
Thank you.
Cool, man. Thank you very much for the chat.
Awesome. Thank you. Well, folks, it's just been a lot of fun chatting with them. Thank you for joining. Please stay tuned next time once again. My name's Alex MacPhail, and this is High Performance Teams.